Sinds Vivienne Westwood in 1977 samen met Malcolm McLaren kleding voor de punk-rockband The Sex Pistols ontwierp, staat ze voor avant-garde design. Westwood en McLaren vormden onder de punkbeweging de harde kern van de Londense clubscene, door met hun ontwerpen de toon aan te geven.
These are the clothes that I wore since 1975. They were made for me by Vivienne Westwood. I had a chauffeur and I was driven around and had bodyguards so I wouldn't be pushed over in the punk clubs. In fact, I was not very punk and I was very protected. I was more of a voyeur.
Vivienne Westwood toog naar Parijs. Met haar baanbrekende ontwerpen gold ze veelal als inspiratiebron voor haar collega-ontwerpers. In maart 1995 zorgde ze voor een schandaal in de modewereld door topmodellen dikke kussens onder hun kleding te laten dragen. Ze doorbrak hiermee het belangrijkste taboe binnen het anorexia-modebeeld. Met de collectie Erotic Zones werden billen en borsten overdadig benadrukt.
It's the face ultimately, right? Because the clothes lead up to the face, which Vivienne also thinks is probably the most sensual part of the body.
The face.
Yes, the face specifically.
That's very funny for somebody who really puts a lot of focus also on hips, breasts, as feminine as possible.
Yeah, well, Vivienne's restructuring of the body in that sense. She uses cages specifically in this collection of erotic zones, but it is to accent or accentuate the body. As she says that, first of all, yeah, what she was doing with a higher heel is first putting a, it's like being on stilts or the woman being on a pedestal. And then by building this cage on the buttocks or the concha, she's almost making a person look like an ant, being that there's three circles that are to an ant's body. And so the hips, of course, making the larger, and with her corset shape, which is pulling in the breasts and pulling in very tight on the bodice, it's ultimately making the head the most important thing. It's making the head very, very, very large. So it's really pushing up so that you really focus specifically on the face.
Westwood inspireert haar kleding op 18e-eeuwse kostuums en introduceert ook de Queue de Paris op de catwalk. Dit maakt haar défilés vaak tot een glamorous theaterspectakel, weliswaar met een vette knipoog naar de klassieke kleedstijl van de Britse aristocratie. Zo is haar logo, dat overal verschijnt, een van de symbolen van de Britse kroonjuwelen.
Vivienne Westwood is voor mij een merveilleuse créatrice, sublime créatrice, maar qui est aussi une baroque. Elle est aussi, elle fait partie de ce monde baroque qui est en train de disparaître, en train de basculer.
Dat Westwood binnen het commerciële modecircuit toch wat wankel stond in haar ivoren toren van barokke kledinguitspraken, bleek misschien wel het best uit haar opvallend rustige collectie in oktober 1995, die voornamelijk op draagbaarheid geënt was.
I tried to make the clothes more easy for people to understand, because last season I reached my high point. I pushed fashion to an extreme where the woman was like something out of space practically, I mean, or if you like a fashion drawing, because it was so exaggerated, this silhouette. And this season I wanted people to understand how they can wear my clothes, and I wanted them to look at the fabrication and the cuts and all these things, so I just made it more easy for them to understand by taking away some of these extreme things inside.
Het Groninger Museum opende met Vivienne Westwood een lopende expositie waarin vernieuwende ontwerpers hun collectie zullen tonen. Mark Wilson, curator van de expositie, legt uit wat de functie is van kleding in een museum.
First of all, clothes are meant to be worn. And fashion designers design clothes to be worn by people. Yet clothing also obviously has a sculptural element to it. And the most interesting fashion designers restructure the body, reshape the body, radically working with the shape and the form. So in a sense, the body although not becoming physically plastic, is the shape and form is, yeah, plastic in the sense of sculpture. But there is room in a museum to look at the sculptural aspects of clothing, especially within the Groninger Museum, where architecture, art, and design is all merged, crosses the borders, and kind of questions these issues in the first place.
Power dressing, sterke vrouwen die hun vrouwelijkheid als kracht benadrukken. De link tussen de vrouwen van het duo van Lamsweerde, Matadin en de ontwerpen van Vivienne Westwood is duidelijk. Voor het Groninger Museum legt Ines van Lamsweerde Vivienne Westwood in een van haar eigen ontwerpen vast.
Is it that Vivienne?
She's timeless. It's very, very beautifully made. And very, very clever ideas. She's a great designer. Fantastic.
She does really so feminine things, like put women on a,
it's a dream.
The dream.
We're very lucky.
For she would not consider herself to be an artist, more an artisan. Yet, her attention to detail and form, and once again reshaping the body, refocusing attention on what is the body, how you can manipulate the body, how you can actually change the person with the clothing is specifically, I think, what makes her very interesting.
Actually, the clothes come because of the way we work technically. They start from a technical point and you realize that you can start to do these things. You already started a little bit. When you work technically, you are manipulating materials, and also the body is, you're having to make the cloth enhance the body, talk with the body.
Yes.
And so it is the manipulation of materials, and the more you manipulate your materials, the more you discover ways to manipulate them, ways that you didn't exploit. And so this is what you're constantly doing. And in fact, we pushed and pushed pret-a-porter type manufacture to its limit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And did you think that you, by showing that, like through material and through the image that you bring there, it can counter-react again? It has this strength to counter-react in society.
Well, I just think it's really important to offer people choice. I think the woman is very romantic. I think she's quite alone, and I think she's quite stressed. You know, she's like this. Because these metaphorical winds are around her, and her clothes look as if they're being blown and they're not quite put on properly, but they're stuck to her body like this.
Yes.
And that's because they were cut with this asymmetrical way of cutting things.
Yes.
And in fact, nobody's ever done this before, where they've done such extreme difference from one side of the body to the other, but yet there's a balance completely throughout it.
Mm-hmm.
There's an equilibrium going through the whole thing. Because she's struggling to maintain her sanity, really, in a world which is getting more and more awful, where she feels more isolated.
Mm-hmm.
Because she's a person who likes to think and she likes to read. And so, therefore, it's very difficult for her to have conversation with anybody because nobody reads. And so she must just chatter, and she doesn't like that too much.
Mm-hmm.
In order to do that, you have to study things from the past. You have to look at excellent things in order to have taste, and this is what she's been doing, self-cultivation, but not many people want to do that.
Yeah.
It's just sort of self-abandonment.
last time you told me that you really wanted people to understand your clothes better, because it was very hard to bring it out there.
Well, I would like fashion editors to understand them more. I don't know one fashion editor with an eye for fashion. Not one.
Really?
Not really.
Where does that come from, you think?
Well, they have degrees in sociology and they're sort of trained to be journalists, but they can't tell very well what is good and bad. I'm fortunate that Mr. Fairchild is quite good like that, and so he has been watching me for a long time, and his paper is very important, and he's always constantly promoted me. So he has a certain eye for fashion.
But is it difficult for you to stay there, to maintain what you want to express?
It's not difficult in terms of making the clothes. In terms of the ideas, that's not difficult. We're trying to sort of push it to a point where it in fact, it is personal, because you see on the catwalk, I didn't tell any of those girls what to do.
No.
The clothes tell them what to do, and their own character comes out, or a part of it.
She's been working with you for a long time.
Yeah.
What do you think that she can express with her clothing?
I don't know, she just gets into them, I don't know,
Di Vivienne, quello che mi piace, lei è una persona straordinaria e questo me la fa proprio amare spassionatamente. Quello che mi piace del suo stile è che ha un'immagine di donna estremamente femminile, ma molto, con molto humor, con molto divertimento, con molto gioco. E questo mi piace moltissimo, c'è una grande ironia.
Piece of clothier has all the obsessions of a time, a century in it.
No, I think the last thing people should do is try to keep up with the times, because there's nothing to keep up with. It's all nonsense. And in order to have some perspective, you have to do what I've been saying. It's much better to read a book than to read the newspaper, and it's much better to read the newspaper than to watch television, I guess. I don't know.
What do you think of her as a woman?
Yeah, Vivienne's not an easy person, but that's only because she's uncompromising. And I think when you're an innovator, you have to stick to your guns, because there are constantly people who are going to attack you, because when you're an innovator, you're not doing what the group wants you to do. You're not doing what people are necessarily comfortable with. So, you have to be uncompromising. I mean, innovators rarely have been recognized in their own lifetime. Really, their effects or their achievements are not normally noticed until posthumously, because of that reason, because people are really uncomfortable with change or with people that approach things in a different way. Basically, the single word for that is anarchy. Even if anarchy can be very controlled, is the way Vivienne does it.
De la mode maintenant.
Les anus de la mode, c'est parfait.
Les anus.
Je sais pas si ça peut se traduire en néerlandais, anus de la mode. Non, enfin bon. Oui, ça peut. Alors voilà, c'est pour ça que j'aime beaucoup ça.
Tell me, what were you wearing here?
I'm wearing a Vivienne Westwood dress. She made it for this collection.
Did she gave it for this day to you? Or?
Yeah, she asked me to sit at her table tonight for the dinner.
for you this evening? Is it important to have an evening like this?
No, it's not really. I mean, everybody asks this question, what does the Venus de la Mode mean for you? I mean, it's... I'm going to reply again. It's my PR lady who promotes it, Sylvie Grumbach, and she likes to have me here, and so I just come here. That's all I know, really. But in the end, this voting, I don't know what it is, really, essentially.
You think fashion needs something as an Oscar or evening to get close to the mass?
To get what?
To get close to the mass, away from its tour ivoire.
No, I think fashion is an elitist activity, and I think to talk about it on the television is meaningless, actually. I mean...
Just keep those images, and that's it.
Well, what I would like to see is people looking stunning in the street or wherever, and everybody is so drab, and maybe... And it's not a surrogate for fashion to watch fashion on the television when you can't see it around you. And so, I don't know, people have to find a way to try to see it properly, not to just look at it on the television.
Yes. So you would never think of putting it on internet, your collections?
Well, this is like meaningless. It's like saying, if you want to feed a baby, then put a very big breast on the television and it will grow. It won't grow. I mean, fashion is an experience and television is not an experience. And nobody can experience fashion on the television. So it's quite meaningless, really. But it keeps the sort of prestige in some way. And maybe it's, you know, you can sell a perfume or something, but the people who count for me are my own customers. And sometimes you might see one or two people wearing these clothes.
Would you think of doing like a défilé for the big public so that it will get closer to where people can feel it, sense it?
You can't, because it has to be a limited number of people that see it. And you hope that those people are people who will find a way to try to communicate something to people. But usually they're all trying to listen to find out what everybody else is saying. And so...
So what you're saying actually...
So even they don't communicate very much to anybody. You know, I never look at fashion magazines. I don't see anything in them, really.
But what you're saying actually is that you have to protect the mysticism of fashion to be really passing through something.
Well, fashion does really in the end depend upon the customers. You have to have wonderful people who come to you who you can dress. This is my satisfaction. Anything worthwhile has always been appreciated by a minority. And this point of view, this taste, has eventually been imposed upon people so they know a little bit of something. In the past, people dressed very well, some people, because there was a very big gap between rich and poor. And some rich people had contempt for popular opinion and they dressed very, very well. And in this way, poor people could see something good. Nowadays, we live in an age of democratic envy, where everybody wants to look the same as everybody else, or else they feel uncomfortable. But I feel comfortable if I look great, and there are a few people who feel the same way. But I think that popular culture is a contradiction in terms. If it's popular, it's not culture. And so the only way that the mass of people can have any culture whatsoever is that they can just sometimes observe it if they see it somewhere. Or if they go to an art gallery, they may see some wonderful painting. But doesn't mean to say, I don't know, they can perhaps appreciate something.
Does it make you feel lonely in a way that you are a person who always loves to still dress in a society where it's not accepted anymore?
Well...
For you personally, you feel estranged?
Well, in a world where people don't have any opinions, it's very difficult to have a conversation with anybody, for a start. And so this is a very isolating experience. But fortunately, there are books. And if you look in the past, there are models of excellence. And so you can get a sense of human genius that did exist. And by comparing things, that's how you form an opinion.
She was like anarchist in the 80s, in a way, with Malcolm McLaren. But at the same time, she's very elitist, too. Is that a strange discrepancy?
Well, actually, it was more in the 70s with the punk movement that you might be saying, because I think that's an obvious way to think of anarchy, because she's thought that basically the establishment was creating the rules, and they were creating this environment where people should not think. And in a sense that she says that she was creating clothing basically for the brain dead, which were the punks. But there was something about moving against the establishment. Now, the shift probably in the past 5 years has been more towards an elitist attitude, because she finds that people don't think. People don't use their brains. They just they accept what's on television, what's in newspapers, what's in magazines. They have no intellectual capacity. So that's a very anarchistic approach. Also, it's maybe a radical shift, but I think you can still recognize the line there. Just it's reconsidering what culture is.